Tonight's fun and games are accompanied by dastardly villains' diabolically decadent brown ale. They describe this beer as nice and malty, but also hoppy. And they also say that it pairs well with cookies. Seems like an interesting beer and a brewery with a bit of a sense of humor. So I've noticed recently that a lot of the cool kids have been making their own circuit boards and sending them off to China or wherever to get manufactured and coming up with a very cool looking circuit board. Now, I've made my own circuit boards before, but it was decades ago. However, usually when I'm laying out a circuit, I will just put it on a piece of perf board like this stuff here. But that's not what I'm going to do tonight. I'm going to do it old school. Back in my day, we used dangerous chemistry when we were making our circuit boards, and damn it, that's what I'm going to do too. And just for the fun of the experiment, I'm going to just make a simple little board, mostly just to see if I still remember how and if I can still do it. And it's going to be the classic 555 timer, A-stable multivibrator, with an LED on the output just so that we can see that it's working. And since I'm doing this old school, I laid out the traces, the circuit pattern by hand, just with pen and paper initially, just to make it a little bit easier for me. I used this piece of perf board just to get the spacings correct so that I could work from that. Kind of like that. See, I've got dot spacing. So I did that initially and then drew over it just with my Sharpie pen just to get the basic outline. And then I transferred it onto a piece of copper-clad board and using the perf board as a template just to get my hole spacings. I also used some chart pack drafting tape. This stuff is a little bit less than 1 millimeter wide. And this is some that I've had for decades. It's some that I bought when a store happened to be going out of business, so I bought like 3 or 4 rolls of it. And this is an excellent application for it. So between the drafting tape and a couple of different permanent markers, one's a Sharpie, one is just a generic one, the larger one, doesn't matter. I laid out the entire circuit board by hand onto my perf board. And then I went out to the garage and set up my chemistry. Now, I'm not going to give you the exact formula of the chemistry that I used because I just pulled something off a random website. But back in the day, I remember using the same chemistry when I couldn't get my hands on any ferric chloride because, yeah, the only place that sold it was Radio Shack and they didn't even have it reliably back then. But I did find way back then in one of the electronics magazines that I subscribed to that you could use muriatic acid, which is easily obtained at the hardware store, some hydrogen peroxide, which you can get at the drugstore, and just mix them together in a certain ratio, which, like I said, I don't remember, but I looked up and I'm not going to tell you exactly because it might be wrong and I don't want you killing yourself. And then I set up my apparatus, which I got from the dollar store. I have a glass container with a tight fitting lid. I have a larger plastic tub. I have some baking soda, which can be used to neutralize the acid should any of it spill. And you can see that I've got some of it in the tub outside of my glass container, so just to try and keep the spill contained. I've also got some safety goggles, and I've got some gloves, and I've got a very well-ventilated area to work in. So after mixing the chemistry in my glass container, I drop my circuit board in and just gently agitate it. You can see that I've put some Kapton tape around the edges of the board. That's going to do a couple of things for me. First, it's going to prevent me from dissolving the copper that's around the edges there, which is going to preserve the chemistry a little bit more. But also, it gives me a place to grab onto with my plastic tweezers so that I'm not going to smudge the traces or knock the trace tape out of the way or anything like that. So I just keep agitating it carefully, gently, not splashing. Occasionally pull it out of the bath to to allow the bubbles to clear off and then submerge it again. The agitation just keeps fresh chemical on there and rinses away any of the dissolved material off to the sides. Just keep it gently agitating. This process took between 10 and 15 minutes to complete. Eventually, you can start seeing through the board when you pick it up out of the solution. Just a little bit more agitation to get the last little bits of copper. And there we go. Then I'm going to rinse it off with lots of water, and I'm rinsing it off over this bucket that's got a bunch of baking soda in the bottom of it. So the dilute acid that's coming off as, you know, the water rinses down there is being neutralized in the copious amounts of baking soda. And I just rinse it several times, dry it off, rinse it again. I'll pull the Kapton tape off because there's probably some acid trapped underneath it. Rinse it some more, dry it off. And there we have a completed circuit board. Well, completed etching anyway. So here we are with the etched board. You can see where the Kapton tape was on the sides. I could have trimmed that part of the substrate off, but I didn't have to. I just masked it so I didn't, like I said, waste the acid. And then we have the traces in both Sharpie and chart pack tape. Next step, clean the board up. Person could use acetone for this. I am just using alcohol, which dissolves the Sharpie very well and also weakens the adhesive on the tape. It comes right off really, really easily. Barely have to scrub at all. That took no time at all. However, as you can see, it's not ideal. Some of these traces, well, most of them are pretty good. Oh, there's a couple of gaps in those. Okay, it's not perfect, but for the first time I've done this in, geez, probably 35 years. That's not too bad. I think I'm still going to go forward with it. I'm going to have to obviously repair some of the traces, but that's not unreasonable to do. Again, it's not a great advertisement for this method, but this is how we did it back when I was a kid. So I am going to persevere just like I would have back then. So the next thing I'm going to do is drill out the holes for the components. This is called a pin vise. It holds little tiny drill bits. I'm going to pick one and move along with that. So I'm just going to start drilling holes here. And so back when I was a kid, I did have, from a Radio Shack circuit board kit, I did have a little brace and bit type drill, but I don't know where that is anymore. It was just completely plastic anyway, so. Hopefully, come on. That board is thicker than I thought. Wow. Not used to using this. Is this that fancy FR4 fiberglass? I think it might be. This is going to take forever to drill. It's not the old phenolic resin board that I remember from my youth. There is one hole drilled. That's going to take too long. Fortunately, there's technology to solve this problem. Bring in the Dremel. Okay, that's all the holes drilled. Not perfect precision, but again, I'm doing this by hand. Not doing it with a drill press or guides or anything. I think I can work with this. And to stick with the theme, I'm going to use this spool of 30 or so year old solder that I got from Radio Shack back when I was a youth. Partly because being large gauge solder, it has a lot more flux in it. Let's just tin up some of this and get an idea for how it's going to go. And you don't have to tint the traces. I'm just doing it partly to make this look better, maybe. And partly to bridge over some of the gaps and thin spots in the traces. So there is one piece of trace right there. This one right here, which is completely missing. So I'm going to have to make that up with component leads, I guess. But other than that, I think I got continuity through all the traces with solder bridges and stuff. Again, this isn't ideal, but this is kind of things that you had to do back in the day when you were etching your own and didn't have a perfect job. So now we can start putting components on our board. So you got pin 1, 2, 3, 4. Pin 1 is down that corner. Oh shit. I made a rookie mistake. I didn't mirror this. So this drawing is from the component side. And I put the component side on the solder side. Damn it. I can put most of the components on the solder side, but I don't know if I can do that with the IC. And I guess that could work, and then put all the other components on the other side where they're supposed to be. Got the first few components in, so I'll quickly solder them down. And I'll use the good old helping hands, just like I would have back in the day. There, I think it's as done as it gets. I'll just give it a quick once over with the magnifying glass. Actually, I don't even need to do that. I can use my multimeter just to make sure that I have continuity where I'm supposed to have continuity. Yep, that should be pin 3, yep. Power, yep. Ground to pin 1 and to there, yeah. That doesn't have continuity, okay. That to there, yeah. Pin 3, I think I already did. Yeah, pin 6. Okay. So the only one I'm missing is pin 7 to its resistor. Make a big enough bridge, I should be able to get it. Pin 7. I think everything's got a connection to where it should be. Question now is, will it actually work? And that was always a question back in the day as well. You never quite knew. But it's always an adventure and it's always super exciting when it does work. First try too. That never gets old. So clearly, I still remember how to do things the old way if I have to. Obviously, I made some pretty blatant boneheaded mistakes, especially not mirroring the image. But as you can see, the etch worked. The hand drawing the circuit worked. Is it an efficient way? Oh, hell no. Of course not. Is it fun to try and do things the way we used to do them back in the 70s? Absolutely. I had a hoot doing this. And I hope after seeing that, especially you young guys, you appreciate just how far this hobby has come in the years and years since it started. I actually tried to lay out the board using some CAD software, and I got about as far as I have the last half dozen times I tried to use that CAD software. I threw up my hands and ended up drawing it out by hand. If you're used to CAD, that's excellent. I've tried, I can't even imagine how many times, and I just cannot wrap my head around doing circuit CAD. But that doesn't matter, because there are many ways to do this hobby, and none of them is wrong. Even though I'm sure somebody in the comments is going to tell me that I'm horribly wrong. If they do, they're missing the point, because this was never to do it the easiest way possible. This was always to do it the nostalgic way. I hope you had fun watching me do it, watching me struggle. If you've never seen this process before, I hope you learned something from it. Anyway, questions and comments down below. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.